I want to invite you to turn to a scripture passage from Isaiah. It's a well-known Advent passage, but it's from Isaiah 9. Isaiah 9, and we'll be reading verses 2 through 7. Isaiah 9, 2 through 7. If you're following along in your pew Bibles, it's number 1072 in those Bibles. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So the prophet Isaiah lived at a very frightening time in Judah's history. He had witnessed the fierce Assyrian war machine conquer Israel and remove the Jewish people from their homelands. And that same destructive power soon threatened the tribes of Judah as well and their capital city, Jerusalem. Now, by divine intervention, God's people were spared. But Isaiah, through prophetic eyes, saw another threat on the horizon. Babylon would rise in power and finish the job that Assyria had started. And so Judah hung in the balance. Judgment and destruction would come upon his people if they did not turn from their evil ways. The Holy One of Israel called his people to be faithful servants, but time after time they chose rebellion instead. Hope was all but lost. However, in Isaiah's visions, there were also these beautiful pictures of deliverance, a deliverance that was linked to a mysterious servant figure. Through the prophet, God spoke of a special servant, a suffering servant. And of course, this makes no obvious sense by itself. I mean, we can understand when a person who serves God is used to bring justice to the nations, or is blessed with an abundant life, or is delivered from harm. But it's much more difficult to understand when a person like this suffers. It offends our sense of justice somehow. But you know, in order for God to give his people hope, something profound and amazing and disturbing was going to happen. This obedient servant was going to experience judgment so that those who are disobedient could be delivered from the judgment that they deserved. Isaiah pointed to a boy whose name reminded everyone that there were consequences for how they lived in the presence of God. That boy's name was Emmanuel, which means God with us. Now, God had always been present with his people, guiding them and instructing them and caring for them. But God had a plan to get even closer to his people. God would become one of us. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor. Now the Hebrew word for wonderful is pele. Psalm 78 verse 12 said, God did wonders in the sight of their fathers in Egypt. So God is a worker of miracles and amazing things that are far beyond human ability. In Judges 13, verse 18, it speaks of God himself as Pele, wonderful. And added to the meaning here is the idea of being incomprehensible or beyond understanding. Because the Bible describes God as wonderful, there's no question that when Isaiah describes the promised child as wonderful, as Pele, he communicates that this child would be divine. God himself would enter the world as a little baby. The coming of this child would be the greatest wonder of them all, God's great act of salvation. Pointing to the new king that would arise from the stump of Jesse, Isaiah 11 verse 2 says that the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, the Spirit of counsel and power. Biblically speaking, counsel is that perfect wisdom that enables a king to make the right decisions in governing his people. It is a perfect understanding of God's will. It's knowing exactly what's right and what God's purposes are in any given situation. Now, earthly kings surround themselves with teams of counselors to advise them in different aspects of leadership, but the counselor of Isaiah's prophecy would have no need for advisors. In himself, he would be able to know and discern what is right, and he would be able to know and discern God's will. And let's face it, only God himself can perfectly know God's mind. So to call the promised child Wonderful Counselor clearly implies his divinity, that this would be a true child of God, the ideal king for his people, because he's not just yet another human king. No, he's a wonder of a king, perfect in wisdom and knowledge, able to lead his people with perfect justice and truth. He will be called Mighty God. What this promised child, what this suffering servant was sent to do could only be done by God himself. He would redeem human beings and all of creation. He would vanquish sin and death. He would triumph over Satan. God with us had already been declared to be one of this child's names. Now he is announced as God the Mighty One as well. The name Mighty God must be accepted as an announcement of Jesus' true divinity, just as the words child and son are announcements of his true humanity. He will be called Everlasting Father. Isaiah 57 verse 15 says of God that he lives forever. Literally, it means that he lives in the forever. God inhabits eternity. He is not bound by time as human beings are. Therefore, God does not change. He is the way that he is forever. And Isaiah claims that the promised child is everlasting as well. No ending, no beginning. The child would be God incarnate. Psalm 103 verse 13 teaches that as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Yes, a good father is compassionate. He also loves, guides, protects, encourages his children. Isaiah's prophecy boldly links these two names and attributes them to this promised child. The everlasting father would be this ideal father to all of his children for all of eternity. Finally, he will be called Prince of Peace. The child to come would be the true Prince of Peace, because the kingdom that he would establish would be a kingdom of peace. And in a world that knows so little peace, that is a glorious vision indeed. The child to come would be called the Prince of Peace because he would stand against sin and evil, and he would be victorious. He would suffer for God's people. He would be punished in our place. And in the end, those who put their faith in Jesus Christ will have peace, a peace that passes all understanding. Amen. Now I'd like to turn to John 14 and read verses 1 to 7. If you'd like to follow along, it's on page 1675. John 14, verses 1 to 7. This is Jesus speaking to his disciples later on in his life. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I have two questions for you as we bring this service to a close. Where do you want to go? And do you know the way? These are the very questions that Jesus addresses in John 14. He says to his disciples, "I'm going somewhere, and you are going to come and join me later. In the meantime, I will be preparing a place for you." He goes on to say, "You know the way to the place where I am going." But the disciple Thomas didn't have any idea what Jesus was talking about. He said, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus responded, "I've already told you where I'm going, to my Father's house, to heaven. Now I will also tell you how to get there." And Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him, and you have seen him." What is Jesus saying here? What is his claim? "Since you know me, you have also become acquainted with God Almighty. Since you know me, my heavenly Father has become your heavenly Father." But see, here's the important thing. We talked about it this morning. It all has to do with Jesus. He says, "I am the way. Follow me. I am the truth. Believe in me. I am the life. Live the life you see me living." Those are the directions to get to where you really want to go, to heaven, where all things are perfect and made new, where life will be wonderful and will never end. With that in mind, don't settle down today as though the earth is your retirement home. You, my friends, are just passing through. Because everything we see is passing away. And I think the greatest possible tragedy in this life would be to live as though the world is all there is, when God's promise is for so much more. So, by all means, make the best of every moment while you're here. If you see something wrong, by all means, try to fix it. But as you do, know that Jesus is preparing for you and for me something brand new and exponentially better for all those who have put their hope in him. Amen. At this time, I'd like to read one final poem. This is one of my favorite Christmas poems. It's by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. It's called Christmas Bells. I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. And wild and sweet, the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And thought how, as the day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Till ringing, singing on its way, the world revolved from night to day, a voice, a chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then from each black accursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south, and with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men. It was as if an earthquake rent the hearthstones of a continent and made forlorn the households born of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men.